Welcome, friends, for this monthly meeting. I am happy to see you here in spite of a storm outside and rain. Well, when I look at rain, I feel like rain is a symbol of blessings, because many masters have said the blessings of a master fall upon us like rain showers. And when the rain is heavy, that means a lot of blessings are coming to us. And we have to turn our cups up so that they can get filled up. In the case of the rains of blessings which comes inside, we have to turn our cups inward, not outside. Turning our cups inside merely means that we remember that the truth of our own self lies inside. Even a master, perfect living master, whom we see in a physical form outside, is actually inside. We don't turn our cup inside, therefore we have to see him outside. If you turn your cup inside, you will see him inside. Everything is inside. So turning your attention inwards, inside, is like turning the cup upwards toward the rain. If you keep it upside down, no matter how much it rains, it remains empty. If you think, I can do partially, I have a lot of things to do in this life, I have a lot of obligations and commitments, I have responsibilities, and these are very important for me, I give some time to meditation. It is like placing the cup on a side, just not up, on the side. It does not get filled up. A few drops may come in, and we'll say, wow, we got a lot of drops. And those, we try to tell other people, see how many drops we have, and we share, and become empty again. The secret is to keep attention inside and not share anything. Sharing is not good on this particular matter, because when you share your own experience of the blessing you are receiving, the mind takes it as if it is an act of ego, act of trying to show off, I have something, you don't. We are trying to keep the ego at the lowest level, and by sharing, we are trying to show off that we have something, therefore the ego boasts. And that is why it's not advisable to share your experiences. But you can share information, you can share knowledge, but not your experience. Experience is very important. Somebody wrote to me this morning that because of some unhappy experience with some master in India, I have lost all faith and I question everything. I have begun to question if there is a path. I have begun to question if there is any truth. And I am questioning everything. And I don't know whether there is a such kind or not. I don't know, am I just following another religion and taking it to be spirituality? And I had to send an answer while I was driving here. And I said, very good to question everything. Question everything, but not your experience. Believe what your experience, whether it's inside or outside. If you have an experience, believe that. And move from that point onwards, no more. There is no place for blind faith in true spirituality. We get information, we are told this is so, okay, we have got the information, we'll work on it and see how much we can actually get experience from the information we have got. It is not necessary to believe all the information just because we have heard of it. It is good to use the information for drawing a plan of going and checking it out, of meditating to see, is it real? Are there any problems that come in the way of achieving those goals that were indicated by these different information we get? That's okay. But the belief should be on your experience. It's very important. Hold on to your experience. Build upon it. Build upon it very slow. It is not necessary that we have to leap forward in this spiritual experience. Even if you take one little step every day, good enough. People think that just because we are living in a physical world and we have got a karmic responsibility and we have to pay off our karma, therefore we give a higher importance to the payoff of our karma, to our responsibilities and obligations, than to discovering the truth about ourselves. These are very highly misplaced priorities. We do not get this opportunity to escape from the law of karma, except when we are in a human form. Let's not waste it. We can give a large part of our attention to meditation, to our spiritual goals, and the rest of it is good enough for carrying on the responsibilities of the world. When we give too much attention to the world, we do not achieve more. We only get more attached to the things of the world. And attachment is what is preventing us from going in anyway. So let's be careful. Are we performing our duties in this world in an objective manner? This is my duty, my obligation. I have to carry it out. How much attention does it need? It needs about 10% of my attention, 20% of my attention. Rest is all for my most important thing that I've got as a human being, to discover myself, discover the truth, go home. Why are we binding ourselves over here and not making use of this opportunity? It's a great opportunity. To be a human being is the greatest opportunity that we have. There are so many forms of life around us. They have not got this opportunity around us. Not even people, not even souls that have ascended to higher levels of consciousness. They do not have that opportunity that we have sitting here in the physical plane. Those who have ascended to higher levels, they are knowing everything and knowing that the whole thing is planned in advance. They see the whole script going through, that we are nothing but robots, nothing but somebody already programmed to go through something. We are no more than puppets. And the strings are being pulled by the program, which has been designed. They can see that in the higher levels. Therefore, they go through it. They do not have the chance, should I do it or not do it? They don't have the chance of deliberating. Nor do the plants, nor do the birds, nor do the animals, nor do any other form of life have that opportunity to think, should I do it or not? Is it necessary to deliberate upon an issue? We are the only ones, the human beings, who can do it. And that power of deliberation and what we call free will only exists with us, which looks real. Let's use it to seek to prioritize our life so that we give the maximum attention to the most important thing for which we've got a human body, to find the truth in order to go back home. Haven't we stayed here long enough? Aren't we fed up with what we have seen here? Does it look like our place to stay forever? We can look at our own lives. Look at the lives of everybody around us. This is not our place. This place has this duality of the pain and pleasure, unhappiness and happiness, dark and light. This duality is killing us. We should be able to get away where we belong, which is our true home. And if the true home was very far away, I would also be hesitant to take a journey like that. As it happened, the true home is the nearest place to us. It's as close as you can imagine. It's right inside our bodies at this time. It is right inside a small part of our body, our head. Can you imagine the convenience of it? That the whole travel on a spiritual journey to our true home takes place in such a small little area called our physical head. And that is why I am always emphasizing, do not lose this opportunity. It's a great opportunity that has come. It doesn't come as often as we think it does. With our intentions and actions that we perform here, we can go into several forms of life. Life is not existing anywhere without souls. We are also souls. So is a tree, so is a plant, so is an ant, so is a bird, so is a dog and a cat. Same soul. They don't have different type of souls. Soul is consciousness, it's the same, which makes people alive. And that is why we have to take advantage of this unique opportunity. How do we balance our obligations and balance it with our internal thing? There are two approaches to that. One, give priority to the more important thing and give more importance to meditation, and the rest will be taken care of. Try it out. This is experimental. Give attention, number one, to meditation. Get up in the morning, start your day with your spiritual meditation. And let the rest of the day follow. You'll find it's easier to go through. Things will happen more smoothly if you've done that. Before going to sleep, meditate again. Your night will be like meditation. It's a beautiful way to do it. Highest priority. Now, don't skip these two things. Wake up in the morning, start the day with meditation, end the day with meditation, and sleep well, dream well of good things. The dreams are actually actuated by what you are thinking at the last moment. So that is why meditation helps. Second approach says that what is inside and what is outside are the same. This is a more deeper metaphysical approach. That what we are seeing outside is because of our sense perceptions. If we don't have sense perception, there's nothing outside. If you eliminate all the five sense perceptions, you have no experience of anything outside. The world ceases to exist. But because of the sense perceptions that are operating inside us, we project the experience outside. It's like a projector. If you see in a movie theater, there's a projector. We are sitting in the audience looking at the screen. We don't look at the projector ever. We look at the movie on a screen. But nothing is happening on the screen except a projection of pictures that's coming from behind us. The projector is loaded with film. And there's a light behind the film. And as the film moves, all still pictures, they move at a certain pace, and we see movement on a screen, and we enjoy it, we laugh, we cry, we do everything as if the reality is right on the screen. There's nothing on the screen at all, except a reflection of what is in the projector. The projector is holding. If you change the movie in the projector, everything changes on the screen. We function in this life and create this external experience exactly like a projector. What we are seeing outside is being projected from inside. Any proof of that? Yes. Go inside and see how it works. Go inside and see how sense perceptions work. Sense perceptions are not working through the physical body. We think they are. But if the sense perceptions were working only in the physical body, we could never imagine anything. In imagination, we can do everything that the sense perceptions are doing outside. And those imaginary sense perceptions that work are inside. If you go deep inside, you will find those sense perceptions which can be created to have imagery inside are the same sense perceptions that are working through the body and creating an imagery outside. The first thing the perceptions create is that we have a body around us. And then through the body, we think the whole world is real. It's a very good way to do it. by blocking our knowledge of how it happens, we have made this reality outside into real three-dimensional world, four-dimensional world. It's all happening from inside. If you realize this, and we say there's a law of karma operating, creating obligations for us, where is it operating? Not outside. It's operating inside. You want to know more about the law of karma? How does it work? Then you have to go even beyond the sense perception. Go into deeper meditation. Go deep into the meditation with the inner self. And when you will open up your causal self, which is opening up the mind, you will see how the karma operates only on the mind, nowhere else. What we call law of karma is operating only in our minds, nowhere else. From the mind it projects to the sense perceptions, from sense perception projects outside. If we want to understand the truth about this, then the metaphysical truth is like this, that it's all happening from inside, and the script of that karma has been written prior to coming here and is just being played out. Even what we think is free will is being played out. So therefore, if you have knowledge of this thing and you give priority to meditation to at least reach that state where you can understand your own mind, if you can see the mind working, you will know that karma, how it is created, how it is stored, how it is played out. Then you will know there is no karma outside. It's all inside in the mind. And if you want to say, am I responsible for the karma? Is it my karma? Go even further. Just one step more. And you will find the mind is not ourself at all. Mind has been given to us as a very useful instrument for creating karma, creating realities, creating experiences outside. And the mind is not ourself at all. Our self, which we call the soul, a unit of consciousness, a unit of totality of consciousness, that soul which constitutes the self lies beyond the mind. If we reach that point, which we can, if we are seeking that, our requirement is not to do anything but that, seek to go beyond the mind, seek to go to our true reality, our own self, who we are, and seek our true home. If those are what we are seeking beyond our mind, and not something within the law of karma and within our mind, we will find a perfect living master automatically. How is that possible? Because the whole thing is being created from that karma, including the karma that is created by the seeking, and you find a perfect living master appearing for the same process of karma. So that is why the seeking is the secret. While the seeking is a secret, we appear to have a free will to seek or not to seek. That's what makes the difference. When we take a free will decision, something that looks so real to us, when we take a free will decision here to seek, then we find that the perfect living master appears in our life and he helps us to go beyond the mind. If you go beyond the mind, you'll find we, in our reality, as souls, never had any karma at all. And karma never affected us. What we are so much bothered about sitting here in this reality never bothered us. It was merely a play in an attachment to us, and we were just involved in it because we wanted to experience that play. And experiencing that play, we began to think it's our karma. We have to go through all these things. It was never our karma. But we experience it to generate a physical, four-dimensional, 11-dimensional experiences at different levels. This was merely a way to experience something for which we got the right tools, the mind, sense perceptions, physical bodies, and from these three, to create physical universes, sensory universes, astral universes, causal universes, mental universes. We just got the opportunity to use these tools given to us to generate different kind of experiences and enjoy them. That see the variety of experiences consciousness can generate. It's immense. The possibilities of our consciousness generating an experience is unlimited, immense. Why? Because consciousness means it has the power to be conscious of anything. That's why it's called consciousness. Consciousness not being aware of something, consciousness to generate the awareness. So that is why we distinguish between awareness of something which we have already created by consciousness and consciousness, the creative power. So if you want to go to the totality of consciousness, you discover the whole show is a play of consciousness which is our true self. Now imagine, to realize these things, to experience these things, are possible right when we are in human bodies in a physical state. It's amazing that the ultimate can be experienced right here. What journey are we traveling to find this? Within ourselves, more within ourselves, more within ourselves, that's all. Not outside, not going anywhere outside, all within ourselves. So from that point of view, the easiest way to see the complete triviality of what we think is so important in life is to go within and see how it generated merely for an experience. And we tying ourselves down so much to this karmic pattern which we have created to just live a life. It's a beautiful pattern we create, highs and lows, big and small, all kind of different experiences we have generated. Beautiful. But if we try to say this is our reality, we get caught up in it. Then we suffer pain, we suffer pleasure, we do all kinds of things, and we say this is our terrible life. It becomes terrible. If you know the reality, it cannot be terrible. We go and see movies, terrible movies. We don't say we are terrible, movie was terrible. Here we have a terrible life, why should we say we are in terrible state? The life was terrible, which we created and saw. Good enough. So that is why the combination of what is outside and inside is not difficult to solve. Everything is happening from inside, and look upon the outside as a reflection of what happens inside, and for the free will to operate in this situation, consider what is your duty created by the karmic pattern with which you have come here. The duties are assigned to us by the kind of experience we are having outside. First experience is we are born, we have parents whom we didn't choose, and we are living in a location we didn't choose. And we have been given certain obligations right from birth based upon where we are born, how we grow up, who our parents are, what they are teaching us, what society we live in. All these experiences generated create obligations for us, create responsibilities for us. When we look at those responsibilities, as a traveler on the spiritual path, we should say, what duties do they cast upon me to fulfill from the karma that's in front of me? I have to look after my child, I have to look after my father, I have to look after so-and-so, I have to look after my job, I have to do this. That's my duties cast upon because of my karmic pattern I'm living. Do your duty as best as you can. Now people are ignoring their duties, thinking, oh, we are on a spiritual path, we don't want to get our attention outside. Little realizing that by ignoring what your duty is to fulfill the karmic obligation, you are creating definite conditions for coming back to fulfill it. You're not leaving this world anymore. You're coming back again and again. Therefore, duties must be fulfilled to pay off the karmic pattern which has been created for us. Every one of us know this is our responsibility, our obligation. And we are questioning whether we should fulfill our duties or not. If you are on a spiritual path, of course you should, as best as you can. Krishna says to Arjun, yoga karma su kaushalam. If you want to attain enlightenment or yoga, perform your action with the maximum skill you have. The most skillful, the best mental and physical skills you have, employ them to fulfill your duties that are arising out of your karmic pattern in this world. This is not going against the spiritual path at all. He's fulfilling the spiritual path to conduct your duties, to get over the karmic pattern through which we are going. And then, when you fulfill your duties, do not say what will happen if you fulfill your duty. If I do this, what will I get for it? If you start thinking like that, then you are prolonging your karmic pattern. If you fulfill what you have come to fulfill, you are ending the karmic pattern. If you are going beyond that, you are creating a new pattern. Supposing we have to give something to somebody and we say, I've given you, now you have to give me back. When you give, it's gone, finished. Now when you expect, now what will I get out of it? New karma. You can reduce your karma in a very big way by not going beyond your own duties, including making an effort to do something good without expecting any fruit thereof, without expecting any reward. That's the secret. The moment we go beyond that, we are now prolonging our karmic pattern and it doesn't end. So that is why if we really want to take care of the karma that we come with, instead of crying about it, feeling bad about it, complaining about it, just do your duty as best as you can. And by the way, remember these words, as best as you can. Nobody can do better than best as you can. It may not solve the problem, but you have done your best as you can. You settle the karma. Karma does not mean that the result should be what you expect. Results are independent. Results are not settlement of karma. Best as you can is settlement of your karma. Therefore, we can design our life so beautifully that we live this world doing our duties as best as we can and then putting a major part of our attention on going within and discovering the truth. It works. But when we get so involved in expecting rewards, fearing punishment for what we are doing, thinking beyond our duty what we are doing, we not only prolong the karmic pattern that we have created, but we also get attached more and more, involved more and more these worldly chores, and we have less time, less attention for meditation. They both go together. We have to learn how to live in this world without running away from it. People who run away from the world, that we are going to go into a forest or into a mountain to settle our travel, spiritual travel, to get some enlightenment there, get no enlightenment at all. Their mind is always in that from where they ran away. I've said many times, when you try to say, I don't want this, you get more of it attached to it. It's not a game of running away from anything. Carry your duties beautifully, skillfully. Perform whatever is needed, the action that is required in this world, with minimum of attention required for the physical duties and more attention on the more important thing of going within. This is such a good combination. We don't have come here, oh, we are trapped here, now what shall we do? No, you do what you arrange to do. By the way, who made up all this? Did somebody impose it on us? Or did we have a hand in it? This question can also come in our lives. Why have this bad karma? God, why did you give me bad karma? Please take it away. I don't know which God we are addressing, but the one who did create the karma, if he is God, that's yourself. Nobody else created it. Our own self. Nobody else. How can we blame anybody else? Now when we perform certain actions, what makes it a good karma or a bad karma? How do we divide actions? This is a good action, this is a bad action. Who determines this? Is there any special book written somewhere which says this will be good, this will be bad forever? I have not seen any such thing. On the other hand, I have seen that what we think good and bad in this century is completely different from the last century. What is good and bad in this country is completely different from another country. Therefore, obviously, there is no absolute good and evil. It's all made up by our minds in the society, in the milieu in which we are born. We are affected by whoever is bringing us up, whoever is influencing us in life, and that is determining. But the mind is picking up. The mind is picking up this moral code from all the exposure outside and therefore dividing events into good and bad. And the mind then itself, by its own judgment, says, oh, this is bad. I feel guilty. I shouldn't have done it. You arrange a punishment for yourself. Oh, this was very good. I did a good job. I deserve a reward. You are arranging a reward for yourself. The law of karma is operating on the functioning of our own mind. The mind creates a moral code, and then it follows the moral code and creates the consequences of it. But supposing we go with the flow, like they used to say, we accept what comes. What happens if we go with the flow? We accept what comes. Circumstances dictate, do this, we do it. Rumi, Maulana Rum, was asked this question. That people say, if you live in God's will, you don't create karma. But if you live in mind's will, then you do. What's the difference? He said, people don't know what God's will is. If he has given a plow in your hand, he has expressed his will, dig. You give a pen in your hand, he's expressed his will, write. The circumstances that have been created around us tell us what to do. Do it. But if we begin to go beyond doing it, then we are creating karma. Not otherwise. We are living in God's will. There's no karma. If we are using your mind to say, should I not? This doesn't look nice to me. Maybe it's done. Maybe it's too bad, but once I can do it, we are creating all the karma ourselves. So that is why it's so important that if we want to live in the will that does not create karma, we go with the flow and act according to the signs that are given to us all the time by the universe, by nature. This is what you're required to do. Do it. You have children, you have to bring them up. And bring them up the best you can. You have old parents, you want to take care of them, take care of the best you can. You have a job to do, do the best you can. Everything that is happening around you, do the best you can. And that's called going with the flow, living in the will of the Lord, living in the will of God. But if you try to interfere with your mind, that becomes mind's will. That is why we talk of two wills in our mind. You can call it God's will, or you can call it the spiritual will, the divine will. And the other is, of course, mental will or mind's will. What is the distinction between the two? Mind's will is exercised when you deliberate in the mind and say, should I or should I not? This or that? When that deliberation comes, it's mind's will. When you follow what circumstances tell you, what coincidences tell you, God's will, divine will. Distinction is very simple. If you have to make decisions, and we have to make decisions all the time in our life in so many ways. We have to make decisions in our family life, we have to make decisions in our businesses, our jobs. When we have to make a decision, if we make the decision intuitively, this is right, I have to do it, do it. But if we say, is it right or not right? Should I do something else? Becomes a mental will. People have asked me that our mind is always making our will. How can we develop spiritual will? We want to develop spiritual will and divine will. How can we develop it? Is there something we can do? Only divine can do it or God can do it? And I always say, no, you have a hand in it. A very simple, simple way to do it, just say no once in a while to your mental will. The mind says, I want this. When it wants very badly something, say no. The mind says, just one time, no. It's an exception, no. If you can say no to the mind when it wants something only 3-4 times a week, your spiritual will develop, I can tell you. But we are not used to do that. We go with the mind. Our mind decides what we should be doing. Mind says it's a bad thing to do, we do it. Mind says never again, and we do it again. All the time. I asked once, how many of you remember a time when you said we'll never do it again and still did it? If I put this question to you today, has it ever happened in your life you said this I will never do it again and still did it? How many of you? Almost everybody. That reminded me of the story I once told about two hunters who were in the Alps or somewhere where they were hunting for some animals that lived there. And they were able to capture and kill 4 of those animals. They had taken a small plane to go to that hunting place. And the pilot of the plane said, this is a small plane. You got these big animals that you killed. Don't take all 4 of them. Take 2 of them at a time. And they said, last time we took all 4 in the same size plane. What makes you think that they won't fit in? And they forced all the 4 animals into the plane. The plane crashed, as the pilot had suspected it will. In the debris of the plane, these 2 emerge and says, where are we? Other fellow says, same place we were last year. This is the lesson we learn. We repeat the same things over and over again, in spite of knowing the consequences of it, in spite of knowing it didn't work last time. Therefore, when we are able to say no to our mind and stick to the no, that no is being said to the mind by your spiritual will. And because we are saying no to a mental will, it has to be something else. So our spiritual will develops when we are strong enough, and we become stronger and stronger as the spiritual will develops. We can become as strong as we like. Our spiritual will can become the overwhelming will in all decisions in our life if we start saying no when the mind wants something very badly. But the small things we have given may not be that effective. When the mind wants something really bad, that's the time when you should be able to say no. So it's a process of elimination, they used to call, that is not a direct development of the spiritual will. Spiritual will is already there. It expresses itself through intuitive awareness. What we are supposed to do in life comes to us intuitively, not by thinking. It just occurs to us. It's a gut feeling. We just know what to be done, but then we suppress it by thinking about it and trying to make sense of what is logical, what is mentally good to do. We are constantly doing this. We are constantly suppressing the spiritual will by overuse of mental argument within ourselves. We are overdoing our logic. We are using logic for everything. And when we use logic, we think we are making sense of things. That's what logic teaches us. You come to good inferences. When we use logic, it is of two kinds of logic. I've sometimes explained earlier. One is called deductive logic. Deductive logic says, this wall is colored brown, that's a part of the wall, it is brown. That means in the data, the premise that is given, you are given a data and a small part of it will correspond to the data that's given. No new knowledge. Deductive logic has never given any new information. It's only confirming an information within the data from where you start. Then there's inductive logic. Inductive logic says, if this wall is this color, it turns around, which I cannot see, most likely, most probably, it is also the same color. Inductive logic depends upon an estimation. It depends upon an inference of which you can never be certain. And that is so important that in physics we today, we adopt the uncertainty principle. The whole quantum physics is born of the uncertainty principle. We are uncertain when using inductive logic of any kind. Therefore, we are living in a world of uncertainty. Can you imagine? The more we use our mind, the more uncertain we become. The more we try to figure out by our mental capacity, the more uncertain we become. It's amazing. Whereas we think that the thinking with the mind will solve our problems, it creates more problems than it solves. Simple reason, because the data in front of us, when the mind thinks of something, is very limited. What it can recall, what it can think about, what it thinks is the data available for making a decision is very limited. When the decision has been made, and turns out to be wrong, we did not have some clue about a data that comes up later or we remember later. Always happens this. That is why we're living uncertain lives. Where if you turn this around, supposing you say, I am going to go with the flow with my intuitive self. I'll follow what my intuition says, mind I will use. I will use the mind to carry out what my intuition says, not the other way around. Your life will change, it will become a life of certainty. Try it out. What I am suggesting to you is not a theoretical model I am talking about, it's a practice. Anybody interested in smoothing out your life can try it out. Make your decision intuitively, use the mind to carry them out. Implement them. Your life changes. So, but we are living the exact opposite way. We are constantly relying on our mind and our thoughts, what we should do. And even if intuitive flashes come to us, gut feeling comes to us, we negate it, we destroy it by thinking about it and saying that is not likely to happen. Because intuition sometimes says things the mind does not accept. And we go with the mind, not with the intuition. And then we know it next day, this happened, but we repeat the process again and again. There is a reason for these things, which we are not fully aware of. The reason is that the mind we are using in our body today is not a creation of this brain of ours. We think the thinking process is taking place in the brain, and we're trying to study the brain so much. And every time we study, we see much, much bigger problem than we realize. The brain is showing up so much stuff which we can't explain. But the mind that thinks, we all know how it thinks. We are all familiar with the functioning of the mind. How the mind thinks, how the mind argues, how the mind reasons, how the mind makes sense. We all know it because we experience it. The brain is a mass of gray matter. It's part of the physical body. It dies when we die. But we do not realize that the mind does not die when we die physically. It's very hard to accept when we think the brain is everything, the brain dies. How can the mind be alive? Mind holds memory. Mind holds memories of millions of years. Not 10 or 20 years or 100 years, millions of years. If you go to the mental level in this physical body where the brain is inside, you can remember the thoughts, the karma of the mind million years ago. You can go to the only to the astral plane, the sensory plane. You find even sensory systems don't die. They live much longer. Only the physical body, the outside portion, dies. The rest remains intact. Same soul, same mind, same sensory system survive. When they go into new body, physical body is new, the rest is all the same. We have been changing our bodies for a long time with the same mind. Therefore, since we have every time we got a chance to have a human body, we relied heavily on the mind. So the mind has got such so much power over us that it is not a power created in this life. It's a power created over several lives. That is why it's so hard for us. Otherwise, it's a very simple thing. If you are aware, oh, mind is a very limited instrument. I don't rely on it. I make my own decisions, tell the mind what to do. Have you ever thought that we can instruct the mind what to do? Mind, think of this and make it think. When they teach us mantra, repeat these words, what are we doing? Mind, repeat these words. We are telling it. Who is telling the mind? The self is telling the mind, repeat the word. Mind says, no, I want to think of something else. And you bring it back, no, you think of these words. We automatically know that we are giving some instruction to the mind. Why can't we give the instruction all the time to the mind? Not get instruction from the mind. We can do it. But the difficulty is because we have empowered the mind to such an extent that we are beginning to believe we are the mind. That's what's happened. I think, therefore I am. Utterly wrong. I am, and I have a mind to think, therefore I use my mind to think. That's correct. The mind is not our reality at all. But we've been given a useful instrument to use. Use it. Don't get used by it. But we have been used by it for so long, it's become a habit with us. The mind also likes to form habits. It's part of its nature, structure. The structure of the mind, the thinking mind, is that it can develop a habit, which is supposed to be a good thing. So if you have to do repetitive things, the mind can learn something. The learning process is to have a habit. When we talk of learning and knowledge, what are we doing? It's merely to generate habits of remembering certain things, of going over those things. Every day we wake up, we know what to do. Automatically we get ready the same way. The mind is almost autonomously functioning by the habits it has created. Because of this nature of the mind, we can generate a new habit. We can create a habit. The mind says, what should I do today? Ask us. And they'll give instruction. That habit can also be created. We don't deal with the mind the way we should. We should use the mind as something useful for us. And not that we allow ourselves to be dragged by the mind where it likes, which is happening. We don't even know who we are. We come to such a state because of the mind. The mind has taken this thinking power to such an extent that it doesn't even allow. How has it become capable of thinking? Who has put life into it? Who has put life into our sense perceptions? Who has put life into our physical body? Where is the life coming from? Surely not coming from thinking. Surely not coming by seeing things. Surely not coming from having a body. Life is coming from being conscious and coming from the self, from the soul. The mind is totally dependent for its functioning on the soul. So are the sense perceptions, so is the body, so are all these levels of bodies around us. They all depend upon the soul for life, for activity, for awareness, for experience. If soul is not there, everything dies. We empower the mind with our soul. We have ourselves empowered the mind, and then we say we are the mind. How can you do that? Use the mind. Use it effectively. Use it as much as you like. Think whatever you like, but make the mind think what you want it to think, not what the mind by itself want to think and tell you what to do. You tell the mind what to do. Have this greater reliance on intuition. People tell me, we like to use intuition, but we are always afraid it may go turn wrong. I said, how often have your mental decisions turned wrong? Just compare. You judge yourself. This is part of experience. When I say experience is the most important thing, this is part of experience of life. That if you have used your intuition and made the mind follow it, how often have you gone wrong? And if you only use the mind to make decisions, how often have you gone wrong? Look back your own life. You'll find out the superiority of intuition. It's a question of personal experience. Mind will argue against it. We have given so much strength to the mind, I'm sometimes surprised the mind is like a separate entity. We are negotiating with the mind what to do. It's a machine. We are negotiating with a machine. It's supposed to be operating under our power, our life we have given to the mind, and we are supposed to be negotiating with it. We are supposed to say, now mind, don't do this, do this. What is happening? We are supposed to use it the way we like. How have we empowered the mind to such an extent? This is because of our history, long history of the mind, that we have overused it all this time, and therefore now we made it our master. It was supposed to be a slave of ours. We become its slaves. The master has become the slave. The slave has become the master. What an irony. Are we all living merrily in that state? It should bother us. How did we give the power which is ours, of the self, the power of our soul, our intuitive self, that can operate without time and space? Our self operates outside time and space. Our self has an intuition with no duration at all. It comes spontaneously. When we have an intuitive flash, it does not take time. Every thought takes time. The mind cannot function without time, and we operate without time. You should know the difference very clear. Every intuitive gut feeling is spontaneously with no time, and every thought is with time. And yet we are relying on the thought which is working in time. So that is why when we understand the distinction between ourselves and the mind, we get to know better. The other option is meditate. Meditate in a very different way. Meditate to observe your mind. Not meditate merely to repeat words as a thought. Mind is functioning and going about its own business. The mind is constantly thinking of other things. Biggest problem we have in meditation is that we want to concentrate the mind on repeating words we want it to repeat, and it simultaneously is thinking of other things and going away, not letting us stay even at the third eye center. Let us meditate and watch the mind. What is needed for that meditation is very simple. We know that as conscious beings in this human body, we are operating with the knowledge of our conscious point in the head behind the eyes. That's very important to know, that when we are in a physical body and we are awake, the point from where we are directing everything, the point from where we are watching the world, the point from where we are listening to the world, the point from where we are directing the body to move, the hands to move, the legs to move, is in the head behind the eyes. Right in the center. That's from where we operate. Let us meditate by imagining we are sitting there in a comfortable place. Not difficult. It's imagination. Take the body and make it into a house, imaginatively, and sit behind the eyes, and don't try to think. Just watch how the mind thinks. You keep quiet. No direction to be given. Nothing to be said. You are sitting comfortably watching thoughts. Thoughts are of two kinds. In a language and in image. Words will flow. Mind thinks in words. Word will flow. Images will come. Don't interfere. Don't participate. Relax backward. Relax with a relaxing place. Watch the thoughts. See what thoughts come. Don't direct the thoughts. Don't put any thought of what you want to think about. No. Just watch the bizarre thoughts going and you will be surprised to see the functioning of your mind. One big thing will happen if you perform this meditation even a few times, that you are not the mind, that you can watch its functioning separately from you. When you do that, your understanding of the mind becomes better. Then you realize just a machine working. And just because we have loaded up with so much information, we loaded it up with so much memory, that we are constantly relying upon it, without ever telling it what to do. You can use it to remember things. You can use it to communicate. You can use it to talk to people. You can use it to write. You can use it to do anything, but you use it to do it. If you allow the mind to just function, it never stops. By the way, it won't happen that you are waiting for the mind to think and start thinking. No. Anytime you sit in the center of your head and watch, mind is already thinking. You'll go into the thinking stream in front of you. A good way to understand that you are not the mind. You are separate. You are life. You are the observer. You are the experiencer. You are who are getting the awareness of everything, including your mind, including your senses, including the physical world, including all other worlds. You are the observer. You are the experiencer of everything. You are not the experience. You are the experiencer. Don't put experience ahead of the experiencer. That's what we are doing all the time. We are putting an experience happening in this world ahead of ourselves. Put the experiencer ahead of your experience here. Put the self above all. Now, when you talk of the self, some people say, this teaching of some mystics, oh, discover yourself, is a most selfish thing to do. What is selfishness? They accuse people who are discovering their own self of something selfish, little realizing that when they talk of selfishness, they are not talking of the self at all. They are talking of the ego of the mind, which is a totally separate thing. The ego of the mind, which makes you into an I want to do this, I will do this, I will do this. That I-ness that comes up, that ego that comes up, that alone is selfish, not the self. The self is the most sharing one, the most charitable, most generous. When you discover it, separated from the mind. The ego is what is selfish, not the self. So when we start identifying our I-ness, our ego as ourself, naturally all the problems come up. Is ego a good thing or a bad thing? Sometimes this question comes up because many scriptures, literature, is talking of the problem that ego creates. And we have somehow thought ego must be a bad thing. Supposing we try to crush our ego. say, no more I. And I remember I met a very spiritual lady from Germany. She says, I have learned that I is not a good thing. So she would always say, we have found this. Or what was her name? She gave her an Indian name and say, my name is Dayavanti. Okay. So instead of saying, I want to talk to you, Dayavanti wants to talk to you. And she said, I've smashed the ego. The ego has just changed its name. It's still the same ego. Now, some people say, we can destroy the ego by genuine humility. I am the most humble person in the world. Why? I'm claiming to be the most humble person. I tell you, a person who says, I am very humble, has more ego than a person says, I am the strongest. Because the one who's the strongest, you can tell him you are not. But the one who says, I'm the humblest, you can't say anything. This is all ego. Now, the question arises, even trying to press the ego down, is it good or bad? The way we talk about ego, it's not a good thing. If we have no ego, we will not have any seeking and we'll never do meditation. Do you realize that? What makes us do meditation? What makes us follow the spiritual path? Our ego. If the ego disappears, we'll do none of these things. So how can you call it bad? It's only a question of how you use it. Ego itself is neither good nor bad. It depends on its application, on its use. That is why, how do you actually handle the problem of an I-ness which separates us from everybody else? Perfect living masters have suggested a way. They say, don't think it is your ego at all. Put it on your master. Master doing everything. Not only in terms of putting master as a name for your ego, that you, in your consciousness, expand your ego to totality, which master is. You're functioning in totality. It's the expansion of the ego. The ego is bad when it's so small. It's not too bad when it expands to totality. That is why when we start by saying, master does everything, and we realize, if we start saying this, what happens? In our daily life, we begin to see things happen. We say, this could not have happened, but by master's grace, master's blessing. When those little events start in our life, we really begin to believe everything is being done by the master. Where is the ego gone then? It's a huge ego, master's ego, but not the one that separates you, not that I-ness. That is why it's a useful thing. Even to start by saying to yourself, master does everything, and then watching him do. And by the way, when you start saying this thing, somehow or the other, I've noticed, master starts doing things for you. It's amazing. So many people have had experiences, me particularly. Ultimately, I found he does everything. And I can see it. So that is why these are matters which we don't tackle in the way they should be tackled. How to deal with your mind. You cannot fight the mind all the time. That is a simple question of fighting, especially in meditation. In meditation, we want to do our simran, repeat our mantra, and we want to repeat those words. The mind keeps on thinking of other things, almost like in the battle. And every time the mind thinks of something else, we say, come back, start repeating words. We sometimes get angry also. Come back and repeat. We are using this language of the mind against the mind and telling it to come back, and then we start, again the mind goes away. We again bring it back. Our meditation consists of a continuous battle with the mind, mind trying to run out, we trying to bring it back, to repeat the word. And we try it with the watch. 2.5 hours? It's a torture. 2.5 hours to fight the mind, and then we're exhausted. Wonderful meditation. What did we achieve? We won every battle and lost the war. That's what happened. No, that's not the best way to deal with the mind. I'll tell you from experience. You cannot fight the mind because the mind will continue to do what it does. Simply ignore the mind. And I'll tell you how. You are sitting here, you are concentrating your attention on where you are sitting. Not anything else. You are concentrating your attention on being in the center of the head. And once you feel you are in the center, you forget about the head. If you keep on thinking of the head, you are always in the physical head. But once you feel you are in the center of the head, then keep that awareness of the center, not the head anymore. Another mistake people make, they think we have to constantly remember where the center is. Then they're constantly fighting to find where the center is, remain in the head all the time. The whole meditation goes trying to center yourself in the head. No, once you center yourself, that means you pull yourself from the rest of the body into that, and there you are sitting. You are aware physical eyes are in front of you. You are aware the ears are on either side of you. You know your throat is below. The top of the head is above. You are sitting comfortably. Once you've done that, then forget the body. If you keep on thinking of the body after that, you never go anywhere. Forget the body, but retain that place which you found. That is the center. That's the third eye center. You'll always be there and operate from there. Now, once you place yourself there to meditate, you will hear the mind thinking. Don't think. Don't participate. Put your attention on being there, period. Put your entire attention on being there. Best being there. Mind is thinking, let it think. Mind is thinking thousands of things. Your attention is not on what the mind is thinking, but on where you are. Mind will give up. And you will then be able to repeat your words. And then you direct the mind what to do. Strength will come by ignoring the mind, not fighting the mind. Most of us are spending our time just fighting the mind. So that is why these are little things I am sharing with you, all these problems that have come in my life, all these things I'm sharing with you, I've gone through this whole phase. And it takes a long time. If I have spent over 83 years after initiation, it's the gist of what I have found in these 83 years I'm sharing with you. I'm not sharing any book knowledge. I'm sharing what actually happens if you are really a spiritual seeker on a spiritual path. So that is why all these tips I'm giving, they have worked. They worked for me. I'm sure they'll work for you. If they don't, then you can try something else. But I'm only suggesting what has worked with me. I hope it will help you. I'll be breaking for now, and I hope to see you for a little while again at about 3:30. Thank you very much.